I've been hearing a lot from security experts. You don't know if your remote employees are using Windows 7 at home on their personal devices, and that can be a big security risk. So what are some of the security threats associated with Windows 7, and how can you prevent them? Stick around. Hey everyone, welcome back to Today in Tech. I'm Juliet Beauchamp. I am here with Computerworld contributing editor Preston Gralla and of course our Windows expert. So Preston, thank you so much for calling in and chatting with me today.
Thanks for having me.
So I am curious, what are some of the immediate security risks and potential security threats associated with still using Windows 7? You know, we know that Microsoft isn't patching anything, but what does that mean for, you know, your remote workers that may be using it still?
Yeah, it's a very, very, very serious problem, because what it means, starting in January, this previous January, just in time for the pandemic, Microsoft stopped supporting Windows 7. What that means is no more patches, and especially no more security patches. Now, there's constant threats evolving for every operating system, particularly for Windows 7, because it's an older operating system and hackers really target older operating systems. And so now there are no security patches. And so what that means for security is pretty simple. You're computing without a safety net. You're going over a chasm. You don't know if you're going to fall, but if you fall, it's all over, because all that has to happen is a hacker just needs to get into even a device at somebody's home. They can use that to crawl through a network. They can, for example, when somebody connects using something called remote RDP, remote device protocol, what can happen is they can then get directly into your server. So basically what this means is that you are completely open when an employee uses Windows 7. And I have to say one thing about this, which is that it's not just home users. A surprising number of enterprises still have Windows 7 devices. Now, I'm not sure how many that are, but to give you a sense of the scope of the issue, is that according to StatCounter, which measures this kind of thing, 20% of all Windows PCs in the entire world are running Windows 7. What does that mean? Well, some estimates say that means 200 million devices are running Windows 7. So it's a big problem. There's a reasonable chance that if you're in IT, you're supporting people who are using Windows 7, either at home, even in an enterprise device at home. And so they're wide open, basically, is what it comes down to. Wide open to any kind of attack. Now, it's scary, but there are things that you can do in the short term. In the long term, of course, the answer is simple. Get them off Windows 7, get onto Windows 10. You have to do that in the long run. The pandemic is extreme, but it's the new normal. People are going to be remotely computing for as long as there are computers. You need to get there. Obviously, now's a tough time to do it. So there are things you can do in the interim. First thing is you can actually get security patches for Windows 7. You're just going to have to pay for them. It's called extended security updates. And for people who have Windows 7 Enterprise or Windows 7 Pro, you can buy those updates. It's $25 per device per year. That's for Enterprise, $50 per device per year for Pro. That number's doubling, and so that means 50 and 100 for Enterprise, 100 and 200 for Pro. That's an estimate, by the way, because there's all kinds of tricks and stuff like that. And, you know, big, if you use a lot of devices, maybe you're going to get a break on it. But as a rule of thumb, that's what you should do. And it's clear. Buy it, because the cost of a security breach is incalculable, really, to your enterprise. So you really need to do that. Another thing to keep in mind, it's not just Windows 7 itself that needs to be patched. You're running a lot of software on top of Windows 7. And if you're running Windows 7, there's a reasonable chance you're using old software, or you're using the Windows 7 client version of software, which might be extremely out of date. Now, Windows 7 is vulnerable, and so are Windows 7 clients. I'll give you the scariest example. Zoom, which plenty of people who work have been using over the last 4 months or so, and will be using for a longer time, the Windows 7 client of Zoom had a security hole in it. Not the Windows 10 version, but the Windows 7 version. Now, the day after that was found, Zoom patched it right away. But Zoom patched it, that doesn't mean individuals patched it. So if you're in IT, you got to make sure that everybody patches not just you know, ESU for Windows 7, but patches the software running on Windows 7, like Zoom, like anything. They need to regularly look for every piece of software. It's not just software. It's also browser plugins, Flash, Java, anything like that. A lot of these are old and outdated. In fact, a lot of them aren't even supported anymore. So you got to get rid of those. And then finally, there is a lot of software. If you're running Windows 7, you're probably running some really old software. And a lot of that software may no longer be supported and has no security patches, and you can't even update it. Get rid of it. I mean, it's really, really insecure.
So it kind of...
Go ahead.
It kind of feels like you just never want to be the low-hanging fruit here, right? It just, I mean, if a hacker is going to have a lot easier of a time getting into any system through a Windows 7 hole or a security issue, they're going to go for that because it's just going to be the easier, it's just going to be the easier get for them.
That's exactly right. I mean, you hit it right on the head. There, in fact, I'll give you a perfect example. There is an old exploit around called Bluekeep. Now, I talked a little before about remote desktop protocol. Remote desktop protocol is a way to connect to an enterprise network and use all the resources of that network. There is an attack called Bluekeep. Bluekeep, if somebody is using RDP, Bluekeep allows them to get into the server. Bluekeep, if you're running Windows 10, you don't need to worry about it. Bluekeep on Windows 7, you can get in through Windows 7 via Bluekeep. And so there's a lot of other malware like that out there. And so you're right, they're going after Windows 7. In fact, there's a security expert who says anybody who's using Windows 7 today is, in his words, a sitting duck. And so it's bad. It's bad out there if you're using Windows 7. It sounds like I'm trying to scare you out there. And it's true. I am trying to scare you because the truth when it comes to Windows 7 and security is scary, and it's especially scary now. It's like Juliet says, they're going after you. You have to really be careful.
Mm-hmm. So I'm curious too, you've already sort of said, and it seems like, you know, the widely agreed upon opinion is, if you're still on Windows 7, the first thing that you want to do, or the best thing that you should be doing, is getting off of it as soon as possible. But I'm wondering too, about these are all of these remote workers, right? And like I said in the beginning, something I've heard a lot from security experts is, if you all of a sudden asked all of your employees to work from home, you know, rightfully so, they may not have work devices or, you know, work laptops, and or they might just have a work desktop in the office, but they're not bringing that home to their house, or maybe they are in some cases. But if I'm, you know, an employee at your company and you told me to work from home, and I now only have my personal device that happens to be running Windows 7, what's the solution for me? What would you recommend IT teams in that situation do? Obviously, giving every employee a brand new work-issued laptop with Windows 10 is going to be extremely expensive.
That's a great question. And it's a great question because IT isn't necessarily even going to know who has Windows 7, who has Windows 10 out there. I mean, you can't protect what you don't know exists, right? I mean, you need to know, first of all, what do people have? And then, you know, not just what hardware do they have, what software do they have, what software do they have running on top of the operating system? There's a lot of things you need to do to manage all this. And so what you need to do is you need some kind of remote management tool. Now, if you're in an enterprise that uses a service provider to do a lot of your IT or even your security, you can outsource your security parts of the security. If you have any arrangement like that with a service provider, immediately call them and find out what remote tools do they have. You may be surprised. It's a surprising number of these service providers have these remote tools that allow you to find out what devices are being used out there. What services are they using? Are they using RDP? Or what software do they have? And so check with your service provider, first of all. Use those remote tools to manage devices remotely the way you're probably already managing servers remotely. And so the same tools for managing servers may well also help you manage devices. If that falls short, if you don't have a service provider or they don't have remote tools, there are a lot of third-party remote tools out there, or one from Microsoft itself. Microsoft has one called Intune. And Intune is designed exactly for that, to manage remote devices. So my recommendation would be check with your service provider. If not, go to Intune from Microsoft or another third-party one. When you do that, find out, you know, just look at every single device on your network. When I say on your network these days, I don't just mean your physical network, because there's not many people on that physical network anymore. I mean in your extended network. So use remote tools to find out what they're using. Once they do that, you know, take control of the patches. You can't always rely on individuals to do the patches. Use remote tools to do the patches. Use remote tools to uninstall software. Make sure to do things like Internet Explorer is the default browser on Windows 7. Don't use it. It's insecure. So remotely, you could change the default browser in everybody to, for example, Edge for Chromium or Chrome or Firefox. So if you do all that as a remote IT person, you're going to be in pretty good shape, not just for today, but for the future, because it, well, let's hope the world doesn't get this bad again, but there are going to be other problems. There'll be other epidemics, pandemics with global warnings. There's going to be warming. There's going to be storms. So get used to the future. Start using remote tools.
So it feels like in the long term, the solution is obviously get off Windows 7, but it does seem like these remote tools are something that are going to be definitely helpful in the short term, or especially when, you know, your team just doesn't have the budget to upgrade everyone to Windows 10, for example.
Right, that's true. And actually, you know, these remote tools are not just a short-term solution, because as I've been saying, you know, this is the future. This is not a one-off, what we're living through right now. And so you need those remote tools, not just for Windows 7, you need them for Windows 10, because let's face it, Windows itself is the hacker's biggest target in the world for a simple reason. It's what everybody, not everybody, but the vast majority of people in the world use. There's always insecurities in Windows, whether it be Windows 7, Windows 10, or whatever else Microsoft is going to be cooking up. So start using remote tools now. They'll be very helpful for Windows 7, but even for Windows 10 and whatever you have coming up in the future, they'll be useful for that as well.
Sure, because not only is it, you know, a great time, it's, I think that this time especially is a great time to deploy these remote tools and these, you know, remote access management, whatever it may be, because, I mean, everyone's in the same boat. Almost all of your employees are remote right now, and then you can prepare, like you mentioned, for future instances in which there perhaps is mandated work from home, or even just, I think that this experience is going to open up a lot of companies to hiring people, you know, around the world, because as we've learned, you don't necessarily need to live within, you know, an hour of your office if you can do a lot of your work remotely. So it also just is important to make sure that you're able to remotely manage remote employees, you know, all the time, not just right now.
Very good point, because a lot of enterprises are already saying, you know what, work remotely in the future if you want. Facebook, 50,000 employees. They've already said to their employees, you know what, if you don't want to work in Silicon Valley or San Francisco, if you want to work someplace else, we're going to let you do it. Now, some, not all employees, there are some they want, you know, on-premise. But other than that, tens of thousands of employees just in one company are going to be allowed to do this. So, yeah, you're absolutely right. This is the way the future is going to be. And, you know, and it's not just remote tools that also they should be testing out now, but it's also remote ways of getting everybody into the same network, even though they're living in different places. So one example of that would be having a single source of truth. What that means is have a website or a series of websites where people know, you know, how do I find out what's really going on at the company or in the world as relates to the company? Don't let it people whisper or send emails or something like that. Have a single source of truth that has on it all the information about what's live and what's not live, what's down, what's up, what are the security protocols you need to use, what tools that are enterprise approved for remote access should you be using, those kinds of things. So in addition to tools themselves, there's also sort of a new way of working that IT needs to get used to.
Well, thank you so much, Preston. I really appreciate you calling in and chatting with me. It feels like there's some really good tips here and just more information so, you know, IT teams can make better informed decisions about the remote employees and, you know, make sure that their remote employees are being safe while we're all still working from home in some cases for the foreseeable future, or in other cases, like you mentioned with Facebook, forever. So I really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Thanks for having me.
And thank you all so much for watching this episode of Today in Tech. If you liked this video, be sure to give it a thumbs up and subscribe to our channel. Hit the bell icon in the corner so you're notified every single time we post a new video. If you have any questions about Windows 7 security or how to manage your remote workers if they're on Windows 7, please leave them in the comments below and I'll get back to you, or I'll get back to you on Preston's behalf. Thank you all so much again for watching, and I'll see you next time.